Andy, my dude, have you heard of the magical website builder known as Squarespace?
Ugh, not another Squarespace ad. I feel like every podcast is sponsored by them.
Hey, don't knock it till you try it. Yes, okay, it is overhyped. But actually, it lives up to the hype. Squarespace is like a website fairy godmother. With a click of a button, your site transforms into a beautiful masterpiece.
A website fairy godmother? That sounds interesting. What makes it so magical?
Well, for starters, those slick templates make anyone look like a professional web designer. Pick one, customize the colors and fonts to match your brand, and voila. Plus, the drag-and-drop fluid engine is so easy, your grandma could build a site on Squarespace.
Well, she did knit me a lovely scarf last Christmas. Maybe website design is next.
Exactly. And when you're ready to sell your Nana's handmade scarves online, Squarespace has built-in e-commerce. Add a store with one click, get flexible payment options, then watch those sales roll in. And when she wants to teach others her steezy scarf skills, Squarespace's new courses feature is just the ticket. Nana can set up her curriculum and enrollments and payments in a snap and become the next e-knitting influencer.
Oh, wow, you really sold me with the grandma angle. Sign me up for that free trial.
Just go to thenextreel.com/Squarespace and transform your site into a beautiful Squarespace masterpiece.
Well, thanks, Pete. Even though it's overhyped, Squarespace actually sounds perfect for Nana's site's needs. Appreciate the warning on the ads, though. I'll brace myself next time I listen to a podcast.
Anytime. Let me know if you need any help getting that site up and running. Andy, can you believe we've almost hit 700 episodes of The Next Reel?
I know, it's crazy. And with all the other episodes in our family of podcasts, we are well over 1,200 episodes of movie conversation. It's really pretty amazing that we've gotten to have these in-depth movie chats every week for over a decade now.
And we couldn't have done it without our loyal community of film fans. Their support over the years has meant so much.
For sure. That reminds me, we should give the merch store a shout-out. Buying shirts from thenextreel.com/merch is a great way listeners can continue to support the show. Plus, they get to sport our great designs.
Absolutely. I think sometimes folks forget we have a variety of shirts, mugs, phone cases, and more available. In fact, a great place to start is with a shirt sporting the Next Reel's logo.
We also have that classic Fast Times Spicoli Surf School tee, or the weirdly popular Rusty's European Tour shirt.
The one from National Lampoon's European Vacation. Why is that so popular?
Search me, but we have sold a ridiculous number of those. I guess there are a lot of Rusty's taking trips to Europe?
We're always adding new designs based on movies we've covered, like our brand new design for a streetcar named Desire, featuring a streetcar named Desire. So if you want to rep your love of TNR and films, head to thenextreel.com/merch.
Every purchase helps us continue to have these weekly in-depth conversations. So visit thenextreel.com/merch today.
And as always, thanks for listening and being a part of the Next Reel community. We've got lots more great movie chats coming your way. I'm Pete Wright.
And I'm Andy Nelson.
Welcome to The Next Reel. When the movie ends,
our conversation begins.
In just a matter of seconds, you're going to hear a classic episode of this show from back in the day when we called ourselves Movies We Like.
It took us a while to settle into the show's format, so you'll notice some differences as you listen to these episodes. For instance, it takes us a bit of time to actually get into the conversation about the movie, things like that.
But we're still proud of the conversations about the movies themselves, and we think they're worth keeping in the library.
So enjoy these episodes from our back catalog. And you can become part of our Discord community, learn more about the show, and find out how you can become a supporting member at thenextreel.com.
So thank you, everybody, for downloading and listening to The Next Reel. We appreciate your time and attention, and we hope you enjoy the show. I used to have more screens. I used to have, like, the NORAD kind of a setup with multiple monitors, and I was the coolest kid at work, and...
Is that what it takes?
I don't know. I don't know. And somewhere along the line, I decided, you know, I think consolidating is good. And that sucks. You don't want to consolidate. Because as soon as you consolidate, you lose the resale value. It's very tough to go back once you consolidate.
And one of the monitors I had was free. It was a really nice one. It was a freebie because they didn't... This is brilliant. I went to... When I quit my last corporate job before I started freelance, I went into the IT person. I had this big cinema display, right? And I said, here you go. And they said, what is this? And I said, it's the monitor that the company gave me for to do, you know, design work and stuff. And they said, we have no record of that. I said, you have no record that you purchased this thing? And the IT person, who's a dear friend of mine, she said, you know what? It's just going to sit under a desk here. I'll tell you what. Anybody ask questions, I'll call you. For now, you can use it at your house. I never got a call. I got a free monitor from work. She said, it's better than a watch. That was what I was going to get. You know, they sent this email that said, hey, you've been here for 10 years. And we really appreciate your service. Thank you. We love you. You're awesome. You are fantastic. Please click on the link below to choose from your set of 10-year anniversary gifts. This email is not monitored. Please do not reply. No one will respond to your request. Most sensitive email ever.
That's love beautiful.
The man. How you doing? How's your week? You feeling strong? How's your chi flowing?
Do you ever find yourself marveling at the deep recesses of the human brain?
Is that a quote? Should I know that?
It's that not you? A quote.
That's really
I
you?
Have found myself marveling at the deep recesses of the human brain.
Tell me about that. What does that
the
look thing, like?
The things that you pull from long ago in your...
Oh.
You know, the things that all of a sudden,
right.
Like the last couple of weeks, I have found myself like humming a song or singing like a piece of a song. And then I stop and I think, why is that song in my head? What is that song? What am I actually singing right now? And then I have to like go like YouTube or go to the computer and search some lyrics. I'm like, wow, of all songs, that is the one that popped into my head right now. Why
can you,
is that?
Can you give me an example? What are we talking about? Are you singing Fraggle Rock again?
No, I'm not singing Fraggle Rock. No. It's just like I now I can't even remember.
Yeah, yeah.
The
now
song.
I put you on the spot.
Yeah, it's like gosh, what is the name of that song? It's one of those songs that just came into my head, and I was singing like one set of lyrics, and it was something about like, if I had wings, oh, if I could fly, I'd pick you up. That's it's in my Google search. I could find the, and it's okay. Here it is, Benny Mardones, Into the Night. I don't
wow.
even know who that is. I don't even know if I ever even knew the name of this song, but clearly somewhere it's like, you know, ingrained in my mind from an elevator or a grocery store somewhere. And yeah, I just like it couldn't get it out of my head this morning.
Wow.
Yeah. It's weird. It's like, how did that stick in my head?
Not, you know, yeah, that's not...
It could be like some formula for, you know, chemistry, but no, it's Benny Mardones, Into the Night.
I can't even place that. I can't even place what that sounds like.
Oh,
that's well, like a like what kind of time? What's the year?
It's 80s, I would guess. It feels like an 80s kind of smooth jazz sort of song.
Oh,
that's like if I could fly, I'd pick you up.
Oh. Wow, I got that.
It's a total like an elevator song. And I don't know, I don't even know like why that's in my head, but there it was.
Wow.
Like that was what I was singing. I'm like, what is that from? If I could fly, I'd pick you up. And
I'm sorry for you.
Yeah.
Well, it's better than Cisco, the thong song. That was me. Somebody, you know, I told you I went to XOXO this weekend, right? Since we half spoke, last time I said I was going to go to XOXO, and you know, it's fantastic. It was really awesome. I'm not going to, you know, go too far into it. There was some great film stuff. It was film and animation, all this wonderful sort of experimental indie, film and animation. And they launched, Empire Uncut. Remember Star Wars Uncut? mm-hmm. the fan, you know, fan cut. They assembled all the scenes from 1,500 fans. Well, they did Empire Strikes Back now as Empire Strikes Back uncut. So Casey Pugh and Jamie Wilkinson and KK Apple were there to premiere the sequel, which was hysterical. It's long once you get it. Once you get the gimmick, but there are some real gems in there. There's some very creative work. But the point is, somebody in a presentation during the day on Sunday said that they actually had more. This was Lee Alexander, I think. She's a writer, woman who writes in the games space, and she says she has more followers on Twitter than Cisco, and she loves the thong song, and so that is some sort of a milestone for her. And I don't really remember the point that she was making. All I know is I haven't been able to get the song out of my head in a week. that is the ultimate ear grenade.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
It's worse than an earworm. It is an ear grenade.
It's an ear grenade. It just blows up your brain inside your brain of song. And it's just thong. The thong song.
I think I'd rather sing Benny Mardones or whatever his name was.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's true, but
do you have any other good stories, or should we tell the people where we're from?
Yeah, let's.
Everybody, thanks for joining us. It's the Next Reel. I'm Pete Wright. That over there is Andy Nelson.
Howdy.
And we spoil movies. This week, we are continuing our Stephen King series with the fantastic Creepshow, 1982. But before we do that, you should get to know us a little better. Head over to thenextreel.com. You can catch up on all our past episodes and our monthly film board fan chat. We're very excited. We've got another one of those coming up. And join the conversation. Facebook.com/TheNextReel, Twitter, The Next Reel, anywhere that there's a place that you can put The Next Reel after it, we will probably be there. So you should go to those places. And now, this week, back to Stephen Smart versus people outsmarted. We don't know whether he is Scottish or a member of the United Kingdom, but we do know that he got pretty dominated this week.
It was a week of a little dominance put down on Mr. Stephen Smart, who day one, it didn't take very long after posting that first image for Hump Thug Nasty to just pin it right to Stephen's back with Unbreakable. And yes, so that made for a very short week, but it made for a week of a lot of really fun images, I'll say.
That's it. What do you think of that that film, Unbreakable?
You know, it's a film that I felt was all right.
really? Did you feel that?
Yeah,
that's it.
It was. Yeah, that's. Yeah, I mean. I know it has its ardent fans. I know it has its all of its haters. I know it's very much kind of got both of those camps. And I've never been either of those. I find it a very slow film. And I kind of understand what Shyamalan was going for with it. But, you know, I don't know. I don't think I ever quite got really into it. But I didn't think it was awful.
I loved it the first time, like with most Shyamalan films. I should know better that I should never see his films twice, ever. I should not do. I should have learned the first time,
or some of them once.
Yeah, right. I mean, okay, that's fair. But most of them twice. If I see them a second time, I'm going to ruin the moment. And that's a mistake. Yes. So I should learn, and I sometimes haven't. This is one of the ones that I should have listened to that inner voice, and I didn't. And then it sort of soured on me, so it didn't really stick. But visually, I think there's some really interesting things going on, and I love the images that he chose. I think they're quite striking.
Yes, yeah. Yes.
And you're back in the seat this week. Right.
Yep, I'm going to be picking it up again for a couple weeks. So.
Excellent. Well, Stephen has to, you know, depending on the outcome of the big election, because, you know, Stephen is he's across the proverbial pond from us. Mm. He's actually, if my Google Maps is right, he lives very close to Edinburgh. Am I saying that right? Edinburgh, Scotland. Yeah. So he's in Scotland, and they voted today, and I don't know what the outcome. They're still counting, as far as I know. I don't know what the outcome is. But we've been talking quite a bit about that in our back channel. So our thoughts are with the, you know, it's a big decision, creating a new country.
Do you think it all has to do with Nessie?
Why would it have to do with Nessie? Like bragging rights? Yeah. Squatters' rights?
Yeah, maybe the UK is like, no, we really need to make Nessie ours.
Said by no one in the UK ever. Let's do trailers. Andy, I think you should go first, because I've already forgotten which one I'm doing.
I think I am going to go first. My trailer this week is for St. Vincent, which if you haven't seen the trailer for this yet, you definitely need to go out and see it. It looks like it's going to be a lot of fun. Another really just fun kind of cranky old man performance by Bill Murray. And as the kind of a cranky neighbor who ends up befriending and kind of mentoring the young boy who lives next door with his single mother, played by Melissa McCarthy, another of my favorites. And then he also has his stripper friend, Naomi Watts, the lady of the night, who is in the mix in this story. And it just looks like a lot of fun. And, you know, I enjoy watching Bill Murray in a lot of these sorts of roles. I think it is the sort of thing that is just fun to watch. But the thing that I found interesting is, you know, there was a story, I think it was in Variety last week, about a guy, about the director of this film, Theodore Melfi, who wrote and directed it. And it was kind of like this story about, like, hey, how do you go about getting Bill Murray to be in your film? And it was just this story of this journey he went through, because he's not a big name director. He's done a number of short films and a TV movie, and that's pretty much it. He hasn't had a lot of credits. He's done some more producing, but again, it's all shorts and stuff. So, but he, you know, he ended up getting this script, you know, optioned by a production company that had a producer who had the magic 1-800 Bill Murray phone number. And so then it was just this process. And he basically left message after message, and just kind of, you know, all sorts of different kinds of messages, trying to get Bill Murray to be interested in the story. And he would kind of pitch it and everything. And then randomly one day, Bill Murray called him back, and it started this conversation. And Bill Murray wanted to kind of, you know, look at the script. And so he had to mail the script to some place up in upstate New York where Bill Murray happened to be. And then he didn't hear for a couple weeks, and then he finally heard, and Bill Murray wanted to meet, and it couldn't work out because he was doing another project, and then so it had to be, you know, a month later or something. And it's just this endless back and forth of trying to coordinate with him, because Bill Murray, you know, he's this actor who doesn't have an agent, doesn't have a manager, doesn't have any of those people anymore. He just does things when he wants to, and you have to have that magic 1-800 Bill Murray phone number to get him involved. And so it was a really fun story about how this guy actually got him to be in it. And it looks like a great Bill Murray performance and something that I'm going to enjoy.
I think it does too. I did not know any of that story about the 800 number, and I now want to get an 800 number.
Who doesn't?
And you know, I think I need to just post it places without my name attached to it and just see what happens.
That would be pretty funny.
Like, the magic...
The key is you have to have a voice that's not yours leave the message. I mean, have the recorded message.
Yeah, like you would do it.
Yeah, or somebody with a Scottish accent, perhaps.
Yeah, ooh.
Or a UK accent.
Ooh, either one, we won't know until probably a couple of days, tomorrow right. Maybe. Okay, that'll be good. So that's a plan. We'll put that in motion.
Yes.
And we should see this movie.
Absolutely.
All right, good pick. When's it hit, did you say?
I didn't say. I believe it's going to be opening. It's been kind of a limited thing, but it's going to be opening in October, I believe. Limited October 17th, and then it looks like wider on the 24th.
All right. I like it. We'll see it. I'll be there.
Let's go see it.
All right. My trailer this week is one that I'm actually sort of surprised we haven't talked about. This is a most violent year. In fact, I think I'm surprised because you swear that we've already talked about it, but it's not there anywhere. So,
well, I feel like we talked about it in our 1981 series.
Yep.
In context of, I feel like maybe it was, I don't know, Escape from New York or
something violent.
Those, yeah. And actually, it may have been My Dinner with Andre, just because he gets on the subway. see the messy subway. I honestly can't remember.
Well, and that's the gist of A Most Violent Year. It is a thriller. It's set in New York City during winter of 1981, and that's it plays off of the fact that this is one of the most statistically violent years in New York City's history. And so it's all about an immigrant family trying to make their way in this world turned upside down with violence and decay. And so it looks really great. It comes from J.C. Chandor, who hasn't done a whole lot, but what he has done ends up having some big ticket people in it. You know, he obviously did Margin Call, and after that, All Is Lost with Robert Redford, and then A Most Violent Year is, and he is also slated to direct Deepwater Horizon, the true story of the big oil spill. So he's got a lot of stuff coming up. It stars Oscar Isaac, who I like very much. You know, Oscar Isaac. It was Llewyn Davis was the last thing I've seen of him, but I deeply liked his performance in that movie.
Drive.
He was in Drive. That's right. David Oyelowo, which I also like. He did Planet of the Apes. He did Jack Reacher. He's been around a bit. Has a quite a distinctive. Oh, yellow O. That's how they phonetically pronounce it there. Oh, yellow O.
Mm.
Fancy that. I've been doing it wrong.
I hear that's how he likes you pronouncing it, though.
And Jessica Chastain.
Chastain.
is also in this film. So, you know, it's got a great cast. It's got an innovative and intriguing director. And I think it's set in a very interesting time in New York City's history. And it happens to be set in a time, that is very close to my heart, these early 80s. I'm a big fan of the early 80s. And so I look forward to this film. It's got that sort of Godfather 2 vibe to it. So, I'm excited about it. Comes out December 31st of this fine year.
Right at the end of the year.
Yeah. Yeah, they're gonna really drive home that point of the most violent year.
Yes.
Just gonna really put a fine point on it.
That won't be too far off from when we see Oscar next in Star Wars.
I know. Are you excited about that yet?
I'm maybe a little bit, but yeah. I'm trying not to get very excited.
It's coming.
Yet.
Here it is. It's bubbling up.
It is.
Mm-hmm. Andy, I need you to just check down there. It's the most amazing thing. She's just in a ball under the stairs, and she won't come out. You can talk to her, though. She'll listen to you. You're good with people.
Coming soon. Jolting tales of horror. Creepshow. From the author of Carrie, The Shining, and Cujo. And the creator of Night of the Living Dead and Dawn of the Dead. You'll scream at ghastly ghouls. Cringe at weird kids. And shiver at the doings of evil doctors.
This is going to be extremely painful, Mr. Verrill.
Creepshow will grab you, grow on you, and give you the creeps.
No, this is going to be an entirely new experience.
Creepshow, the most fun you'll ever have being scared.
Jordy, I mean, Andy. Creepshow, 1982. This is our second in our Stephen King film and Stephen King series. And this one, I'm just going to say it. I had a lot of fun watching this movie.
I have always had a lot of fun watching this movie. This movie, I put up on my Letterboxd after I watched this. I can't remember exactly, but you know, basically it's like, there are films from your youth that no matter what, they will always go down as classics in your head just because of the time of your life that you saw them.
Yeah.
And this is one of those films that, I mean, it came out at a perfect time. I actually don't think I saw it in 82. I'm sure I saw it a few years later, but I started watching it at a perfect age for me to be watching this movie, and it's just burned into my brain, and it's just so much fun to watch.
It is. It absolutely is. And I'm with you. I mean, I didn't see it. It was actually a surprise watching it. I'm sure the Amazon reviews are going to be all up in arms about the quality of the transfer. because that seems to be all that people get up in arms about. But I saw, when I first saw this film, it was a copy of a copy of a copy of VHS. And it was terrible. I mean, it was just terrible. And it was probably, I was, you know, I think I was, you know, spending the night at a buddy's house or something. And we were messing around and put on Creepshow. And that was the first time I saw this movie. And I remember it at the time. I remember it being scarier than it is. It's really not. But some of the images, it really stuck with me in a just crazy way. And I feel like we should probably do a show on each one of the vignettes, right. In spite of my drive for restraint. But I'll tell you, when that kid starts going voodoo on his dad, that's one that wasn't scary when I was a kid, but now it is.
Now, right, it's, you're in a different place now. Wait a minute. Hey, watch out for what Junior's reading.
That's right. So one of the biggest treats about this film is just the it pulls together a fantastic cast in to go through these little vignettes, these Stephen King vignettes, and some surprising casting catches in this film that I had forgotten. I'd completely forgotten, for example, that it was E.G. Marshall battling the cockroaches. Completely forgot Adrian Barbeau. Completely, I did not forget Hal Holbrook or Leslie Nielsen and Ted Danson. Those are fantastic performances.
How about Ed Harris?
Ed Harris with hair.
I completely forgot Ed Harris was in this.
Completely forgot.
I had no idea how fantastic of a dancer he was.
So what's how do you want to walk through this thing? You want to start vignette by vignette?
Yeah, I guess we can go through each vignette and then just kind of talk about everything else as a whole.
It starts with a little bookend piece where we meet actually Stephen King's son, who carries the mantle of the bad seed generation after generation. He's just he's a horrible boy, and his friends who hang out outside his window are horrible, horrible people. Well, they're dead. They're also very dead. So it starts off with this. We get in a fight, and he introduces this concept of, introduces us to the context of the creep show. It's based on a comic, and Dad doesn't like the comic. And I love this intro because it after the blow up where the kid says, "Don't throw it away, Dad. Don't throw it away." He throws it away out into the gutter, and the dad says, "That's what fathers are for. That's what fathers are for." I found myself saying that.
What a brutal, brutal man.
Just bad. So that's how we meet the we are introduced to the show, and once we do that, we get this we start getting these beautiful transitions, these comic transitions, and they really are they are homage. The whole film is an homage to these old horror comics, of yesteryear. I was not much of a fan of horror comics. Were you?
I wasn't. I don't know if I ever read any horror comics. I think I was just more into kind of the, superhero sort of comics.
Yeah, I mean, it's these old sort of, what was it called? It was like EC Comics, educational, or entertaining comics.
Right, entertaining comics starting in the 40s into the 50s, and I think ending in the 60s.
Ones that introduced us to, like, Tales from the Crypt, and right? I mean, those were the early ones.
Right, yeah, that was the big one that they had. And then there's, the whole idea of this film is, all of those EC comics and some of the early DC comics, all those things like House of Mystery, House of Secrets, The Witching Hour, Tales from the Crypt, The Vault of Horror, The Haunt of Fear, all these kind of just things that had been around. It was that time where I guess there was, I don't know if it was just because of war going on and all of that sort of thing. They say the sci-fi boom happened because of the atomic discoveries and all that. So, it's interesting to see why these comics started popping up, but they were very popular. And of course, with this sort of comic book, there was always that discussion of the whole idea of our children's minds being ruined by them and all of that sort of silliness. And, I think that it was, there was a lot of stuff that came out of that as far as, different rules that people were trying to establish and everything. But in the end, I don't think any of that worked, because obviously the comics have continued. And I mean, they are a great little, type of comic that is out there. It's obviously kind of a specialized comic, but they are very fun, and they created these very fun tales. And clearly the filmmakers of this film, particularly Stephen King and George Romero, really wanted to tap into that vibe of these comics and really kind of almost like pay an homage to them, really, in their filmmaking style, which ends up working very much like a comic book quite a bit.
It really does. And, this feels like the best book report ever. You know what I mean? Like, these guys, like Stephen King, George Romero, decided we're going to do something that just really celebrates in the most fantastic and frivolous way, the work of these early comic book artists. And so the art direction, I think, is really, it's a really nice touch. These transitions between vignette that give us the introduction through the, what are we, is the Crypt Keeper? Is that what we're calling him at this point?
I guess he is. I don't know if he's officially the Crypt Keeper. But yes,
anyway,
I think that's,
So we meet the skeleton that sort of leads us through the tale as the host, and we begin with Father's Day. Daddy needs his Father's Day cake.
this is kind of a fun little story. I don't know if I've ever fully understood. Like, that's one thing that I find in all these stories is like the motivation behind the characters. Like, you can't really focus on that so much, because it's like, okay, I mean, this father was terrible to Bedelia, and so Bedelia took this this ashtray, this giant stone ashtray, and smashes him over the head, and he dies. And so she, for 7 years, she goes and apologizes, drinks at his graveside, until finally he pops out of the ground, and because he wants his Father's Day cake, and he kills her, and he goes on a killing rampage and doesn't kill everybody. He kills just enough people until he can behead somebody and make his own Father's Day cake out of the head, essentially.
Yeah, it sounds really insane when you say it, but it makes its own sort of internal sense when you're watching this.
Sure.
This sort of universe that they create in this little piece of wonder. And again, I think they do a fantastic job of bringing in the comic, not just in the transitions, but the comic feel, in the in all the reaction shots and any of the, and there aren't very many jump shots or jump cuts in this film. I mean, really, it's creepy, but there aren't a whole lot of boos. But what we do get is these wonderful sort of extended reaction shots where the background, changes and turns into one of the sort of comic kind of Mondrian comic montage sort of splash things. What are we calling those? What's the real word to kind of that, for that?
I don't know, but it is kind of that comic book background, kind of almost like expressing their internal feelings behind them, like, kind of like an explosion behind their head, like their brain just exploded because of the craziness of seeing a dead person walking around with a head for a cake.
Exactly. When Mrs. What's her name? Danvers? Is that who it is? She's wandering around looking for the, or maybe it was... Aunt Bedelia? No, she was the one who died. I get all the names. I get so confused. Anyhow, the older lady is looking around for why everybody suddenly disappeared and every light in her house has gone blue. Mm-hmm. And she finds the dead maid.
Sylvia.
Yeah.
Or she finds the dead maid, right, yeah.
Right, in the behind the opens the glass, or opens the door, and the maid comes out, and she screams, and that's one of those sort of great moments of comic book frenzy, and I think it kicks off the very, the sort of climax of this vignette when the old man comes out from the grave and with the cake head on a... on a cake, eventually, right. And with a head and a cake, and so in this one we do see Ed Harris crushed by a gravestone.
Yeah, and that's just one of those things. It's like he is so slow to get out of that. If that started moving on me, I would be moving pretty quickly to try getting out of that.
I know. I couldn't tell what he was going for, right? Was it like, oh my gosh, I actually think that there is a connection between every move that I make and the move of this giant. Right. Headstone, right? Is that like I wonder if I'm somehow tied to it.
Right, that's exactly how he acts. It doesn't completely, there's no logic.
No, it doesn't work.
And we haven't seen him drinking. We saw Aunt Bedelia drinking, so
yeah.
But he wasn't drinking, he was dancing. And so it's, his actions there don't quite make sense. And, it doesn't really matter in the long run. And then Nathan, the dead man, He clearly has some sort of supernatural power, because he's actually, like, when we finally see him, he's like pulling the gravestone forward, as he gestures with his hands. It's like he has magic and is pulling it, even though he's not touching it. So
right. But, and the gravestone falls and he pops, and we lose Ed Harris because he pops. Unlike Hot Fuzz, the popping with the gargoyle.
That's right.
Very similar feeling.
Although, oddly, this isn't nearly as bloody as
It really is not very bloody, and it's one of those that I was really tempted to sit down and watch with my daughter, but I didn't. I think I thought better of it. I think the cockroach thing would have thrown her over the edge. But it really is. It's, while it's not quite a complete family film, it's not so much a horror film. It's a motion comic more than anything else. Although we do see the Nathan plumb twist the head off of that poor woman. Not really, just twists the head right backwards.
Yeah,
that was a nice moment.
You know, it's fun if you go over to YouTube. Tom Savini, who is a fantastic makeup person, special effects. He did a lot of this sort of stuff with a lot of George Romero and his films with the zombies and just all of this stuff. And he did all the effects work in this film. And somebody who, I don't know if it's somebody who's tied to him, although it's very strange because this person clearly has access to a lot of footage, like behind the scenes footage of the actual makeup team doing all their effects work. It's Goremeister100 is the username on YouTube. And that person has uploaded, there are like 9 or 10 videos, basically, of the kind of like behind the scenes of Creepshow that you can watch. And it's just, literally, it's like somebody watching or filming with their video camera and just walking around. Like, there's no narration. There's nothing, but you get a kind of a nice behind the scenes look, if you can sit through it all, of the effects work. And it's really kind of funny. I was watching some of it, and it's just so off-putting to see the zombie, or not the, I guess he's kind of a zombie, but, you know, the dead father standing there grabbing his daughter's neck, grabbing Bedelia, and twisting it. And you hear, and it's just all like, you're just hearing it like they're filming it on set. And you hear Romero going, okay, now you're going to twist her head. And she just does do this little twist. And then you hear the guy inside the suit talking, you know, like, well, should I twist it like this? And, you know, it's just so off-putting because there's no music. There's no sound effects. There's no screaming. It's just, and then you see, like, there's actually, you know, a shot from her front as he twists her head, a shot from her back as he twists her head, although she was actually turned around at that point. And then they have a dummy head that he really whips around. And then they just use that to edit. But it's a really interesting glimpse into the behind-the-scenes work of working with effects and how tedious and slow and boring it can be and how you have to get all these different shots in order to have the magic pieces that you need in order to cut it together and make something that works and is effective for the story that you're telling.
That's fantastic. I had not seen all of those videos, and I'm absolutely going to. I think that's hysterical, particularly a film that feels very much like, you look at the cast and crew list on this film, there are a lot of people. It's like a real movie, right? It's a real movie.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
And yet it feels... what's not insulting? Do you know what I mean? Like, it's a real movie, and they used all these people to magically capture the sensation of it being a film that I made in my backyard.
Well, it definitely has the B-movie vibe, you know, and I mean, B-movie,
yeah.
I don't know. There are times when the filmmaking style in this, I look at it and go, wow, this is like the most bland type of shot they could get for filming this. But then there are shots I'm like, wow, they really... they clearly were thinking about that, and so there was the bland stuff that wasn't very interesting to pair with, I think, this fantastical, over-the-top comic book stylized stuff that they were shooting. And, you know, I think that they found a nice way of working this story so that it could balance that out, because you kind of need that yin-yang.
You really do, and I think there's a great contrast between these two vignettes, Something to Tide You Over and They're Creeping Up on You. Of course, the Tide You Over is Leslie Nielsen and Ted Danson, and this is a lover's spat where Leslie Nielsen discovers that Ted Danson's been having an affair with his wife, and he is exacting revenge in a very patient fashion by burying each of the lovers up to their neck in the sand on the beach and waiting for the tide to come in. And he gives them each a TV connected, because they're not in the same place on the beach. And so he gives them each a TV with a very long coaxial cable connected to each other. And so so they can watch each other drown. And one of the things that I couldn't help feeling it, you know, after they do the burial stuff, Leslie Nielsen goes back to his fancy house, and doesn't it feel like a sitcom to you? I mean, everything is taupe. It's very crisp and clean. It just feels very much like a set. It's about as boring as you could possibly find, you know, cinematically. Like, it's it's not interesting to watch. And it's very, very bright. All the lights are on everywhere. Like, there's nothing haunting about it at all. And, I think the contrast of this one to They're Creeping Up on You, which, again, also very light, very bright, the way they use the camera with E.G. Marshall alone in, you know, ultimately alone in his, you know, germaphobe kind of hideaway, you know, the way they use the close-ups to capture the cockroaches and then reverse the camera and do these reverse angles where you see the poison spraying down upon these little critters, I think is a much more dynamic and interesting style. And I think it's fascinating to watch these styles, this completely bland, boring, to really dynamic and engaging, just 20 minutes apart.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, it really feels like different, completely different filmmakers.
Well, and that's something that's interesting with a lot of these anthology films is oftentimes you will have different directors directing each of the vignettes. And you go back through the history of anthology films and you look at, I mean, anthology films have been around and anthology stories have been around, for centuries. But anthology films, they started in the early days of film, 1919. There's a film, I don't know how you say it, Unheimliche Geschichten, something like that.
I'm sure that's exactly right.
Yeah. Somewhere right here, and I'm the only one who speaks that language.
You are alone doing that.
But the horror films really kind of took it on, starting in 1945 with Dead of Night, which is a fun little British film where, it's kind of this, they set up this idea of you've got this framing story of, people coming together and telling a story or telling these stories, and then you go into each of the stories. And this kind of took that whole mantle of telling that type of story in this anthology film. But oftentimes you did have different directors. And that is something that's very interesting with this one is it's all George Romero directing the whole film, but it does feel sometimes like some of these stories were directed a little better than others. And I don't know if they just had more time with some stories than others, or if it was his intention to direct some of them a little stronger or what. But you're right, because that particular story, Something to Tide You Over, does end up feeling a little more bland than like they're creeping up on you.
Well, it does. And what's interesting about that, like Romero did direct the whole thing, but he had different editors working for him for many of these. So, Michael right. Spolin did Father's Day and They're Creeping Up on You. He edited Something to Tide You Over himself, which doesn't actually bode terribly well for his editing skill. But, maybe that's a part of it. Paul Hirsch did The Crate and then Pasquale Bubba did the Lonesome Death of Geordie Verrill. And you look at, for example, Paul Hirsch, and I'm a big fan of The Crate. Like, The Crate is I don't know if it's my favorite one, but it's right up there. I find it a much more sort of engaging, piece of editing. And this is a guy who's edited, some very big action films and some duds like, our favorite Raising Kane. But you know what I mean? I mean, there's this sense that, you can actually start to see some of the trends. Now, Michael Spolin, I don't know anything about Michael Spolin. As far as I know, Creepshow, IMDb shows him as just directing these segments. But again, Pasquale Bubba did Heat. And so, there's another example of that sort of, that gift of editing to the camera, even though they're, we're looking at the same cinematography, the same direction, the power of editing really, I think, changes the dynamic of the vignette in this film.
Yeah, absolutely. And like we talked about, I'm sure that Romero is working on a different level than Kubrick from The Shining, but the editing, it even boils down to which shot did they select to tell the story. And I think that there's something to be said for having a different editor finding the right shots to tell the story in the way that's going to be the most effective. And, something like Something to Tide You Over. While I find it effective and creepy, it all inevitably ends up being one of the ones that I like the least, I guess.
I'm super torn on that one because I know what you're saying, but some of the visuals in that one, like occasionally, like I'm watching along and it's I'm not feeling very spooked, and maybe it's because I have that natural feeling about drowning, that when I see them, they transition again to that comic, the comic art of Ted Danson's head underwater, mm-hmm. After he's I find that just really horrifying. And so that's one that really sticks with me. In terms of the entire vignette on the whole, I find it really sort of a non-starter.
And that's one of those ones that I was talking about earlier, where it's like the motivations for the characters, it's so strange. It's not like you have a good guy and a bad guy and somebody exacting revenge. I mean, here you've got a couple who, okay, they're not killing anybody, but they have been unfaithful. And the husband, who is the one who's really in the right, he decides to exact his revenge by killing both of them in one of the strangest ways imaginable.
Yes.
And so he exacts his revenge, but then the two of them come back from the dead to kill him and to kind of put him through the ringer as well. So it's like, okay, so there's no real good or bad guy in this character or in this particular story. And maybe that's another reason why I find it not working quite so well. I mean, it's a horror story. I don't think you need to necessarily have kind of the good guy, bad guy, because that's one of the fun things about the genre is you can play with that quite a bit. But it doesn't really give you anybody to grab onto necessarily.
You know, it's funny about that when they also change the rules, right? Because what we are introduced in Father's Day to this idea of the decaying corpse coming back after 7 years. Mm-hmm. And then we skip over the lonesome death of Geordie Verrill to something to tide you over where the horribly decayed creatures of the sea now come back after about 45 minutes.
Right. Well, and they're even kind of setting you up to break their own rule again by how do they kill Leslie Nielsen? They put him in the exact same situation. They bury him, so he's going to drown underwater.
Right.
Okay, but you just told us that if you do that, then they're going to come back from the dead. So is Leslie right. Nielsen now going to come back, or is he going to die? Like, what are the rules here?
And I don't know, because in this film, here we are trying to parse rules. But you know, it's funny to me when the rules mess you up. You know, like I find Father's Day completely fine. That there, after 7 years, a zombie comes back, pushes the thing over, and pops Ed Harris, and then puts the head on a platter for a cake. That makes total sense. But in Something to Tide You Over, after 45 minutes, is now a decayed zombie. That's a bridge too far, people. That's you've crossed the awkward line.
Yeah. Right. Something I've never thought about in this film,
yeah,
watching
right.
it before. It's like, you know, when you start thinking critically, okay, that's when you really find these problems. But otherwise, I mean, I don't know if I ever really worried about that.
How does Geordie Verrill stick up for you, stand up for you?
It's what, I don't know. I find his character, I mean, Stephen King wrote this was one of the original stories that he had actually written as a short story that then he adapted into this screenplay. He wrote the screenplay for this. Two of the stories, The Lonesome Death of Geordie Verrill and The Crate, were based on previously published short stories that he had. The rest were original for this film. I've never read the original short story called Weeds that King wrote, but I don't know. The character of Geordie Verrill, as comical as he can be and as comical as the story is, he really drives me nuts.
Yeah,
just like the, you know, I don't know, it's just the idiot kind of the trailer trash sort of character that is the kind of the cliche person who's going to find the meteor that falls from the sky, or you know, the whatever it is.
You know, I cut this one some slack because I think it's fun to watch Stephen King you know, just as young as he is in this film. I find it amusing, and I, you know, maybe it's because I was raised by hillbillies that I find some affinity for them. But what I love about this one, I really genuinely love, is the transformation of the set. I have a great fondness for the way the green, the grass, that sort of alien grass, takes over, you know, not just Geordie, but everything that he's touched, and starts spreading throughout the house and all over the house, and then suddenly down the road. I think of all the stories, this is the one that makes you think, wow, this little vignette has changed the universe of the movie in some way. Right. I mean, this is not just, you know, exacting revenge. This is an alien change that when it's over, I'm left thinking, when is that green stuff going to reach the city? You know,
yeah.
What are they going to do if? And I don't think that about any of these other ones. Not a one.
Yeah. No, I agree. This is definitely kind of set up that way. And I really, I mean, I say that about the story that I find it kind of the annoying, the one that's a little more annoying, and that his character is annoying. That being said, I really do enjoy the style of the story. I enjoy his flashbacks, or his, not his flashbacks, but his, the way that we step into his imagination, right, as he pictures himself getting, taking this meteor to get prize money, or, going to the doctor, or the image of his father, all those things are a lot of fun. And I like the way that they do that, and how they have, like, going back to the comic books, when he's picturing himself going to the doctor, you transition with this great skull and crossbones image, like a mat across the screen, and the picture is playing out inside that shape. And it's just like, it's so much fun.
It is. It's really fun.
Yeah, so it is a very fun story, and you're right, the sets, that kind of, that almost fluorescent green that everything has, and the way that it just kind of slowly pervades, it is a really fun story, and I do like it quite a bit, even if the character just makes me a little crazy.
Yeah, yeah. The crate is the longest of the stories. This is the fourth story. I'm skipping over the Leslie Nielsen, Ted Danson.
We talked about that one.
Yeah,
already.
We talked about that one enough. The crate is one that this is, this is when you bring up the motivation piece. I don't know if it's necessarily the motivation, but the mechanics, sort of the dramatic mechanics of this one, I think are either the most confusing or the most interesting. The way this vignette is set up leads me not at all to the way this vignette ends. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Think it over first. In this one, we have Hal Holbrook who plays his lovely
Adrian Barbeau.
Oh, right, of course, Adrian Barbeau, wife, plays his horrible, yeah, horrible Wilma Northrup, horrible wife. Call me Billy. And Fritz Weaver plays Dexter, and we have essentially these three who custodian played by
Don Kiefer as
Don
Mike
Kiefer.
The janitor.
Yeah, thank you, janitor. And so we have these four, and they discover they're at a garden party for the university, and they we bear witness to Billy's. She just is missing that part of her frontal lobe that allows her to behave well in social situations, and she's just really very horrible to Hal Holbrook and old Henry Northrup, and you feel that he is because he is such a phenomenally talented actor, you could really feel that he is outpacing this film in his emotional reaction to Wilma Northrup. That said, a parallel story, we have Fritz Weaver called in to the basement where Don Kiefer's character has discovered a crate under the stairs that has been right there since, what, 1923, something like that.
Although the stamp on the side of the box is like 1888 or something like that, right?
Right, right, right. Many, many, many decades this thing has been down there. And they decide, what a treasure, let's open it. And unfortunately, Don Kiefer does not make it through the opening. What do you think of this story?
I love it. I really have fun watching
this. Is this one
this
your favorite
book.
One, would you say?
I would say it is. And maybe it's just because they've kind of developed the characters a little more. But I really enjoy everything that goes on in it. I enjoy the way that they play with the Hal Holbrook, Adrian Barbeau relationship, and how he is this really, he's very whipped, and he does everything that she tells him to, even though she's just awful to him. But I love that they let you step into his imagination as he pictures himself killing her. And we get this sense that he is very unhappy in this relationship, but he's too passive to do anything about it. He just doesn't have the right way to actually end the relationship. And I it's always been so fun to just kind of see those moments, like where he just pulls the gun out and shoots her at the garden party, and then everybody else just starts applauding, and you got the one person's like, "What a shot!" or whatever he says. It's fantastic. It's a fun way to do that, and just kind of play that type of a relationship. And then then you've got Fluffy, as they named the giant, I don't know, monkey monster creature that's in the box.
Yeah.
How it lives that long, who knows? You don't ask these questions when you're watching a story like that, because there's no logic to or reasoning to it. But, that creature is just one of those things that just is just a very terrifying creature. And it's like, you know, going back to my childhood, that definitely was something that made me jump when I was a kid, seeing that giant thing with those enormous teeth. And just watching as he, you know, started eating Mike the janitor. I mean, first of all, if you ever uncover a box like this, never stick your hand in it, especially if you see eyes inside.
No, yeah, that's a mistake.
That's just, he's just meant to go. And then you've got that poor student who goes and is going to kind of try helping Professor Stanley with this box. And this is, I think, one of the shining moments of Tom Savini's makeup effects. Watching as this creature... which looks great in and of itself, but watching as it bites down on this kid. I mean, first he takes a swipe across his shoulder, then he just bites into him on his face. And I mean, it's a bite that seriously, I mean, it rips out an entire chunk of his face. And it's gorgeous in the most, you know, technical way of looking at it. I mean, obviously it's an awful thing to see, but the way that they do it is just fantastic. And then, you know, he rakes him across the face and then pulls him in to devour him. I mean, it's so fun.
It is. And, you know, I think just moving back just a few minutes before that, when the janitor gets taken in, there is that sequence when his hand is up in the box and he's already been attacked and you can tell he's exhausted and he's not doing well. And there is this just awful moment where his eyes get a little bit wide and the blood starts pouring down his arm before we actually get the reveal of the monster itself, as the lid opens up and he pulls the janitor inside and eats him. And it's so we don't have that brilliant sort of eating the student kind of makeup effect, but you do get that really that haunting bit of horror as we watch this guy in just sort of broad light be eaten by this monster without giving too much away, that it's you lose the scare.
Yeah, right.
But then it takes us back to, you know, the whole time you're wondering, you kind of know, okay, of course there's going to be a way to tie this back to Hal Holbrook. There has to be. And then I think it really gets good because Hal Holbrook gets to show his glee at figuring out that there is a way to get rid of Billy for good.
Yeah.
And he goes through the mechanics, this wonderful sort of cleaning the blood montage of cleaning up down in the basement. You know, he sees the evidence, he sees the crate there, and he cleans up all the blood and lures her down and says, you know, and with a trick that says, you got to help this girl. She's been hurt or she's scared of my friend. He didn't do, you know, he's not very good. He's not a very good guy. And he somehow abused her, and you need to come help, and lures her in. The sequence where he is shaking her, trying to wake the creature, mm-hmm. and shaking her against the thing in this movie that is so kind of fun and frivolous and spooky, scary, and, you know, not very serious, ends up being one of the highlights of the film, sort of the dramatic highlights of the film for me. I love that sequence because you get to see him running out of steam. His glee has just gone into high gear, and you see that frustration kick in of, oh my God, what if this doesn't work? Mm-hmm. It has to work. It has to work. He gets desperate, and finally she gets taken.
Yeah. It works out in his favor.
It's just wonderful.
Well, and that is a great moment, and I think one of the reasons it works so well is because that is a great look at just like the real psychology of this person. You know, you really, for somebody who we've seen inside of his head so often with his wife, and we understand how annoying and frustrating she is, but we really get to, you know, as he's shaking her and having that, he's going from glee to anger to kind of panic and almost depression, realizing that, hey, this thing might not actually work. I mean, it's great the way that plays out.
It really is. And his, the, you know, the aftermath when he actually watches it happen, and then he has to kind of excuse himself and go out into the hall and recover, you know, from this emotional sort of climax. It's just a great bit in a movie that's otherwise, you know, it's got some funny bits to it, but this really becomes kind of the highlight for me.
Absolutely.
The one I remember the most is Creeping Up on You. We've talked a bit about that, about E.G. Marshall being infested by cockroaches.
This is a hard one to forget.
Yeah.
Once you see, the dead E.G. Marshall basically kind of exploding with the cockroaches pouring out of his body, I mean, you really can't get that out of your head. It is a pretty awful image.
Yeah, it's really horrible. And he carries this one. There are a couple of appearances by another actor, but generally he carries this one by himself. Him in his lair. And his poison, and he ends up getting taken over, by the cockroaches. This was the one that kept me up at night when I first saw it. This was the one that was just because they're so small, you can't see them until it's too late.
Yeah,
the cockroaches.
It's, you know, I don't know. You grow up thinking about bugs, and you know, I get this with my kids all the time now. Because they're the age, but they're, you know, you have these bugs called earwigs. Well, why are they called earwigs? You know, it's like there's no good reason I know of why they're called earwigs. the reason I thought they were called earwigs is because they would crawl into your ear and dig into your brain and lay their eggs. That was kind of the story that I had. So as a kid, you know, you get stories like that in your head of bugs crawling into your body. And it really kind of sticks with you. And I think that's something that Stephen King and George Romero really tap into very effectively here. The whole idea of this kind of bubbling up of something that is unseen from underneath you and all around you that kind of comes out of the woodwork and literally like out of the drains and then just destroys you from within. I mean, it really is creepy.
You've got me thinking now about earwigs. Is that a thing they do?
No, they don't really do that. But
I thought they just hid in the moist, dark places and then came up and ate fruit that you leave out.
Is that what you thought?
I was hoping.
I don't know why they're called earwigs, but that was the story, like, as kids that we all said, oh, stay away from those, because if they get too close to your ear, they'll crawl into your ear and dig into your brain and lay eggs.
It's totally not. I'm on Wikipedia right now. It's totally not what they do. It's in the dirt. They have nests in the dirt.
I know it's not true.
Why do you say these things to me?
To keep you up at night.
Oh, goodness. They squirt a foul-smelling yellow liquid in the form of jets from scent glands on the dorsal side of their third and fourth abdominal segment. That's about as bad as it gets. They stink. And I guess they can pinch on those old tails.
Yeah.
I don't know about that.
They're not very strong pinchers, though.
Man. Well, this has been a horrible conversation. Who else do you want to talk about?
Well, okay, so that's all the stories. I think that the strength of this film falls into the story construction that Stephen King had in really paying homage to these early comic books. And then the direction that George Romero has in creating this world. And like you've already said, the editing plays key with that. The cinematography by Michael Gornick, I think, is incredibly important. The way that they use the lighting, these really dramatic lighting setups and the changes that you don't see very often in films, but where, you know, when all of a sudden, like, the guy comes through the door with the cake, you know, the lighting in the room goes from normal to all of a sudden, as the background behind her changes to that comic book splash, her lighting goes from normal to all of a sudden deep blue or dark red. And the way that they play with the lighting on set physically is, I mean, it's very exciting and it's very comic booky and stylized. And that's something I think that works so well in creating this kind of pulp style is, you know, they all worked together. Michael Gornick, the cinematographer, George Romero, as the director, all of the editors, as you already said, and Cletus Anderson and Larry Fulton as the production designer and art director, really help kind of create this world. But for me, it really falls down to the cinematography, even to some of these great Dutch angles, kind of the tilted angles that you get at the key moments. I feel like it's really solid work, and they just found the right way to pay the homage and make the film work the way it needed to for what they were trying to achieve.
I think so too. I think one of the things that they do that this, you know, particularly when you look at the art direction that and the production design, that as they keep cutting in and out of the comic book, just when the story gets its most intense, then we get this crazy light change, right? Or we get this crazy tonal change, or we go back and we're suddenly in a panel. The transition will take us right into a comic panel, and we'll actually see the borders of the comic. And one of the things that does, or you know, we do this particularly in the crate. We have these the titles, the sort of horror comic titles. This is later in Henry's office or Henry's study with this kind of hand-drawn clock. And one of the things that does for us, I think, is it keeps the emotional sort of tone and tenor for the viewer at a very consistent level. Like, you can't get too scared because it'll bring you back out of it just in time to send you to this next little peak. And I think they it's just paced. It ends up being paced really well. And I think this is a real challenge when you look at these anthology films, that the length can get out of control on these anthology films. You know, if you you know, and I think this one, in contrast, it ends up feeling very natural to me. It's an easy watch.
Yeah, absolutely. It really is.
You got any other you know, good stories, or should we talk money?
Well, I did want to.
We should probably mention again. Did we talk about Joe King? Hill.
Well, you mentioned that Stephen King's son plays the boy at the beginning, and his father is played by
Tom Atkins,
who you know, was just the year before in Escape from New York.
Right. He was. And the, yeah.
Yeah. He's one of those faces just is in a lot of things, lots and lots of things. You know, I don't know if I have anything else. I mean, George Romero obviously is somebody that we should talk a little bit about. He's just kind of a key character in the kind of the horror genre, really, and particularly the zombie genre, because, I mean, really, with Night of the Living Dead back in 1968, and then the other two films, the initial two films in that series, I should say. I mean, he ended up making
Dawn of the Dead, Day of the Dead, and then Land of the Dead when he brought it back, and
Diary of the Dead,
and Night of the Living Dead,
Survival of the Dead. Yeah, so there's been a lot of these dead stories,
right.
But I mean, really, I think in the world of horror, he really is one of those people who stands out for. One, starting kind of as kind of the independent filmmaker mindset, and allowing people like Tom Savini to do these outlandish effects that really kind of helped these films kind of create just a new identity for themselves, I think. You know, they're able to really play around with stuff. I mean, whether it's like the zombie whose head, you know, gets chopped off by the helicopter blades in Dawn of the Dead, or like the intestines getting pulled out in Day of the Dead, or, I mean, there's always something that he was doing to kind of step it up. And that certainly holds true in this film. You know, he used Tom Savini to great effect, creating the zombie bodies of the different people who were resurrected, or Jordy Verrill when he's kind of become the plant monster, or the fantastic fluffy creature that's in the crate. I mean, I love all of that. And then, of course, the real cockroaches that, you know, are just creepy enough. So I think I think that's all I really want to say about George Romero, but I think he's a very important filmmaker, even if he doesn't get his due and likely will never win an Oscar or anything. But I think he is a very important filmmaker in our lifetime that has actually brought a lot to the modern horror genre.
Oh, yeah. I think that's absolutely true. And he doesn't have all that many credits when you look at, you know, what he's been doing over the last sort of four decades. But, you know, those credits have spun off a definitive class of horror films that can all be traced back to, you know, Romero and his teams that have gone on to do great stuff. So I think you're absolutely right.
Yeah. So, so two last stories.
Mm-hmm.
One, so these cockroaches that they used were actually imported from Guatemala. They were hissing cockroaches that they used in the "They're Creeping Up on You" story. They could not actually get the permit to bring them in, an export permit, so they had to use a temporary permit. And so what that meant is, I guess they actually had to count before and after every single shot every cockroach and make sure that they had them all accounted for. And they had, if any of them died, they had to keep records of all the dead ones. And they had to just like keep track of every single one of these so that at the end of it, they could export them back all out of the country because they didn't actually have a permit to keep them. Which
do you have any sense of just how many cockroaches they used?
I don't have any sense, but you know, they had them all in styrofoam egg cartons in a van. So I imagine that, I mean, just picturing a van full of egg cartons, I imagine it's just a lot of them. I mean, when you see them come out at the end, it's just a lot of things.
Yeah. No, it's definitely a lot. I just wonder how many, how many shots they were sort of kind of reused, you know? I mean, do they really need 10,000 cockroaches? Or are we talking about 500 cockroaches or... 500 cockroaches is a lot of cockroaches.
It does seem like a lot of cockroaches. I know that when they actually had the dummy of E.G. Marshall and they had them bursting out of him, there was a couple times where as they were kind of pushing the cockroaches out of the mouth, I guess they were pushing them too fast or something and the cockroaches all kind of jammed and they couldn't move and it was just like this giant kind of cockroach, you know, like... mush thing that just was pushing out of the mouth. So it took a little time to work it correctly, to find the right way to have them come out of him. And even the chest, when they burst out of his chest, he couldn't get these cockroaches to burst out. So they actually had to create this chest on this dummy out of toilet paper that they then kind of painted over. And then they put the blood inside. So when the cockroaches came up, the toilet paper was easy for them to get through, so they would just crawl through the toilet paper and leave their little bloody tracks when they went out.
That's awful. I've been searching here. I can't find anything that says how many there were, but they did supplement them by making many of them nuts and raisins.
Yes.
Yeah. That's awful.
And then the last thing that I want to mention is that for some reason, this is... I don't know how popular this is for Warner Brothers on Blu-ray, DVD, and all that, but every release that they've ever released here in the U.S. has only ever been just the movie and the trailer. However, if you're over in the U.K., you can actually, or Scotland included, you can actually get the two-disc special edition of this that actually has an hour and a half making of documentary called Just Desserts, The Making of Creepshow. It's got a lot of behind-the-scenes stuff, deleted scenes, commentary, all sorts of stuff. And they're actually getting ready to release the Blu-ray. Well, they may have released it by now, but it's even more stuff. And for some reason, Warner Brothers is not taking any of that and releasing it here in the U.S., and I don't understand why. And I was actually trying to see if anybody had posted the Just Desserts, The Making of Creepshow anywhere online, and I couldn't find it anywhere. It's a little disappointing. It's one of those weird things where I don't understand the mentality when you have all that stuff that's just sitting out there. Why don't you just put it out with the... you know, the Blu-ray or whatever, when you release it.
Right, right. It's not doing anybody any good just sitting there.
Yeah, exactly.
Could do me good. It could do me good.
Yes, indeed.
Let's do numbers.
Yeah, so this film came out toward the end of 82. They had a production budget of $8 million. I couldn't find anything for prints and advertising. But, you know, $8 million, still a fairly handsome chunk for the time. Domestically, they call this film kind of a slow burn. It took a little time to make its money back, but it did make its money back. And domestically, it ended up making about $21 million. So they made a profit. I couldn't find anything about international. But, when you look at the adjusted profit per finished minute, it was raking in about $260,000 per finished minute. So did pretty well for itself.
Where does that put it in the stack?
In the stack, it ends up number 85 when it's adjusted. So, it's not at the top of the list, but it still did pretty well for itself.
I love it. I think that's great. What a fun movie.
It is. It really is.
Let's head over to Flickchart and rank this thing.
Let's do it.
Flickchart.com/thenextreel. That's where you can go find our stack rankings of our favorite films on a great service. And you should join up there and you should friend us up there and you can see if your rankings match our rankings. That would be great. And where do we begin?
All right. Let's do it. Hey, this is a perfect start. Creepshow or Carrie?
Hmm. I would say Creepshow.
I would too.
Oh.
I love Carrie, but Creepshow, there, I don't know. Maybe it's just because I saw it when I was young and it's attached to my brain like it won't let go, like a cockroach. Creepshow or 12 Monkeys?
12 Monkeys.
I would, gosh, I feel like I would do Creepshow, believe it or not.
Oh, I believe it. Yeah. I believe it. I just, that's a, that's a vote of, is it a vote of guilt or shame? I don't know what that is.
I'll go 12 Monkeys with you.
All right.
All right.
I know that, that, I know what that does. I mean, that, that,
but that's okay.
I would,
that's
okay. It's legit.
It is. No, I know. I know what you're coming from there. Creepshow or The Town? Very different films that I would watch for different reasons.
Very different reasons. Yeah. The nice thing about Creepshow is that you don't have to watch all of it.
Yeah, you can watch it in little nice chunks.
I still think I'd probably do The Town.
Yeah, I probably would too. Creepshow or Dark City?
Dark City.
I'd do Creepshow.
How much?
I would do Creepshow, yeah. Like really thinking about it, I probably would go Creepshow.
Over Dark City.
Yeah.
I might have to rethink every movie we've ever done together.
I'll give you Dark City, though. I'll give you Dark City.
Well, I mean, I was going to give it up because I feel like I owe you for 12 Monkeys already.
No, it's okay. Don't worry. I feel guilty picking Creepshow over some of these. my guilt is coming out. It's making me bend. All right, Creepshow or Adaptation?
I'm pretty sure you're going to say Adaptation.
I think I am.
It's funny because I would say Creepshow. I'm pretty easy on this one. I think I'm pretty fair split. I'll give you Adaptation on this one.
All right. All right. Creepshow or The Natural? I would do Creepshow.
I would do Creepshow.
All right. It's like we're guilty for picking Creepshow or something.
I know.
It's so funny. Creepshow or Chronicle? I would do Creepshow.
Really?
Yeah.
All right. Okay.
All right. Okay, look at that. Sandwiched between Adaptation and Chronicle, Creepshow comes in at number 71. And that, my friend, is our 150th movie that we've ranked.
There we go. Oh, there we go. 150 at 71.
That's right. That's right. Just above the halfway point.
I like it.
Yeah.
Have you come to any brave new awakenings at 150?
No, just that I have a heck of a lot of fun watching movies.
Me too. Where do we go from here? We're continuing our Stephen King.
Yeah, and you ever just kind of walking along his the early filmmaking days. We're gonna go visit a little farm with a big old dog named Cujo.
Oh, Cujo. So cute. This one I don't remember very much of. I remember being scared, though.
I definitely remember this one. This is one that I watched a lot when I was a kid.
Did you?
Yeah.
That's not a horrible thing to watch when you're a kid. I was watching The Smurfs.
It wasn't that young. It was, you know,
well,
because
when did it come out? We're going to talk about this next week.
Came out in, 83?
Three?
Or four?
Okay.
It was, 83.
This is another one I didn't see in the theaters, though. I saw this much later.
Yeah, likewise. But I had this, I had this taped, and I watched it all the time, and I don't know, burned into my brain.
Can't wait.
Yeah.
I'm looking forward to talking about it next week, my friend.
Yes, indeedy. Now, Pete, I think you better go take care of your bug problems.
I was just going to say I have to go to bed, but the problem is there's earwigs now in my head. And I don't want them in my head.
Oh, yeah, because they lay eggs.
You're a jerk.
And then the babies have only one way to get out. Yeah.
Okay. Mine is actually saying that you should see just one of these particular vignettes. Eddie writes, "I think you'll love Crate." Now, you should know that the entire review is written in all caps.
Mm.
"Love, my favorite is Crate. Think it's a stihas movie, sen it a dozen times at least, and never get tired of watching it. It has 4 or 5 episodes. I think it's a steal for the price. If you like horror movies, get it for your collection. Even if you've seen it several times, watch it on Halloween again. It's cheap. It online. It cost me around $6. !
Wow.
Yeah, I didn't like that
one. The next Siskel and Ebert.
I probably should have read that one before I read that one. It looked funnier. The visual is funnier. Yeah. I don't know what a stihas is.
There is a visual element to these sometimes that makes them work that much better.
Yeah.
Well, mine is
you try stuff.
That's right. Yeah, that's what you got to do. Mine is a 1-star by Filterite, from Dublin, Ireland, who said, "I wish I never had to give this a star. They say horror movies are a test of your wits and your endurance, and this movie does that, but not in the way they may have intended it to be. The acting is so diabolical. You begin to wonder, why the hell did you put your money to waste on a movie like this? The acting is so hilariously bad that when friends and family interrupt and start talking about, 'Think I ought to mow the lawn tomorrow. What do you think, dear?' you gladly give your opinion just so you can get away from the terrible film. Now, when you think of a George Romero film, you think, oh, this might be good because of such classics as The Living Dead Trilogy and Codename Trixie, The Crazies to You and Me, and The Amiable Bruiser. But then this just really tears your heart out. Again, I go back to the acting and how poor it is, but you've just got to see it to believe it. I mean, how do these, quote, actors, I use the term loosely, sleep at night knowing they made a turkey like this? Actually, I'm being cruel. Turkeys have better taste than to watch this tripe. Avoid at all costs. Please, I beg you, don't submit yourself to this torture."
Wow.
Mm.
Wow. You know, yeah. I like that he worked both turkey and tripe into the same,
right.
same thing.
And I like how he says, "You've got to see it to believe it," and then says, "Avoid at all costs. I beg you, don't submit yourself."
That's a good catch. That's a great catch. This was a very complex review.
It is. I really think
so. Many layers. Thank you, Amazon.
Andy, it is hard to believe that we have been having in-depth weekly conversations about movies since 2011.
You are telling me. Producing this show week after week requires a ton of work behind the scenes. If you'd like to help support our efforts, one easy way is by using our Originals page when shopping for books and movies that we've covered.
Just visit thenextreel.com/originals. Your purchases made through our links give us a small commission at no extra cost to you and allow us to keep having these great discussions.
I love The Next Reel Season 4. Do you know why?
I don't. Why?
Because we got to talk about my favorite movie, Terry Gilliam's Brazil.
That's not even an adaptation.
No, but it was such a great part of our great Terry Gilliam series. And a few others in that series were adaptations, like The Adventures of Baron Munchausen, adapted from Raspi's stories, and La Jetée, which inspired 12 Monkeys.
Oh, right. And for our Man with No Name trilogy, we saw how Sergio Leone's A Fistful of Dollars was basically stolen from Kurosawa's Yojimbo.
We added Labor Day to our Jason Reitman series, adapted from Joyce Maynard's novel.
Oof, there's one we'll always regret.
Our big Stephen King series covered adaptations like The Shining, Cujo, Christine, and Stand By Me, great horror and coming-of-age tales.
Another Coen Brothers adaptation, too. We got to talk about how they turned Homer's The Odyssey into Oh Brother, Where Art Thou?
For our holiday series, we did The Bishop's Wife and The Poseidon Adventure.
And who could forget seeing Alec Guinness in the adaptation of Kind Hearts and Coronets during our series dedicated to him?
We really need to do more of his films.
Truly.
We had our first film noir series with classics like Double Indemnity, Detour, and Out of the Past.
And our black and white cinematography of James Wong Howe series with The Thin Man, Sweet Smell of Success, Seconds, and King's Row. So many adaptations.
Oh, you're not kidding. Dive deeper into these originals and more at thenextreel.com/originals. Every book you buy helps support our show.
Get the full list at thenextreel.com/originals and start reading today.